Hi friends, I'm Chandar Puri. Today I have one interesting topic to share with you that is from cardiac pharmacology, especially antiarrhythmic drugs. I know everyone has some idea about these drugs like sodium channel blockers, beta blockers, and calcium channel blockers, etc. But maybe have no idea or less idea about the direct effect of these drugs in the cardiac action potential. Before starting, bring these points in your mind. Sodium, potassium, calcium are the major ions to help the heart to contract. And of course, the beta adrenal receptors, who is helping the adrenaline to contract the myocardia, or we can say sympathetic action of the heart. If any arrhythmia occurs in the heart, we can control that arrhythmia by blocking or regulating the action of these ions. And to make this point more clear, we should understand the cardiac action potential and what is the role of these ions in that. Now we will have a brief idea about cardiac action potential. As we can see here, is a graphic representation of cardiac action potential. It has five phases from 0 to 4, and this we can see a positive flexion and a plateau phase, and going down is the repolarization phase and the resting phase. So all these processes, the cardiac action potential will be within 300 to 400 milliseconds. So the resting membrane potential is minus 85 to 90 millivolts. See here in the graph, we can see it's starting from minus 90. So whenever the membrane potential is getting more positive, we can see a positive deflection in the graph. That means the depolarization phase. And whenever the membrane is getting more negative, the repolarization or the relaxation of the muscle will occur, and we can see a negative deflection in the graph. Look at the graph here. It is starting from zero, okay, zero phase. It's going up. That means the membrane is getting more positive because of the movement of ions. It's getting more positive and the depolarization is occurred, and the phase one, that means a notch we can see in the graph. It's just because of a small brief repolarization. A small repolarization is occurring after immediate of the positive deflection or the depolarization because of the potassium movements in the membrane. I will explain you later. Then a plateau phase. It's because we can see a long phase. This phase because the membrane potential is remain constant for some time, and the phase 3, this is the starting of repolarization because of the potassium movement. The membrane is getting more negative, so it's going, the graph is going down and it's getting to the phase 4 because the membrane is getting more negative up to this resting potential. As we can see here, it is minus 90 millivolts. Here we will see the role of ions in the cardiac action potential. Look at the graph here. It is phase 0. During the phase 0, the sodium channel, it is open, and more sodium will move into the cell. So the membrane potential from minus 90 to it will go up to around positive 50. The membrane potential will be more positive. So if whenever the membrane potential is positive, the depolarization will occur, the rapid depolarization. And once it reaches to around positive 50, the phase 1 will start. During the phase 1, the limited depolarization, as we see the previous graph, the brief repolarization phase. During this phase, the inactivation of the sodium channel will occur, and the potassium channel will open and close. Some potassium ions will move out, and some chloride also will move in. So the membrane potential will get slightly negative. So we can see a notch in the graph. And the phase 2, it is the plateau phase. During this phase, L-type calcium channel will be opened, and more calcium ions will move into the cell, and starting of the potassium ion moving out to the cell. And this movement of the ions will make the membrane potential will remain constant for some time. This is called as the plateau phase, and the contraction will be continued during this phase. And this phase is responsible for the larger duration in the cardiac action potential. And it is very important to prevent the cardiac arrhythmia, because it will this refractory, absolute refractory period, it depends on the plateau phase. The kinetic action potential has two refractive periods, absolute refractive period and relative refractive period. The absolute refractive period, because it is very important, because during this absolute refractive period, it is impossible to get the cardiac muscles to get another contraction, or it just cannot get arrhythmia during this phase. And the phase three means during this phase three, rapid repolarization or relaxation of the muscle will occur. During this phase, the sodium gate is closed and the potassium gate is open, and larger number of potassium will go out. The positive potassium will going out, and the membrane potential will get more negative. So during this negative membrane potential, the relaxation of the muscle will occur, and it will go to the phase four, the resting membrane potential. The high efflux of potassium, we can see here, high efflux of potassium, a larger number of potassium will go out from the cell. So the membrane is getting more negative. It is reaching up to the resting potential, as we see here, it is minus 90 millivolts. Now we'll move to drugs and its classification. Antiarrhythmic drugs includes many different drug classes, and there are several types of mechanism of action. There are many type of classification schemes have been proposed, but today we will discuss the first and widely using Wagens-Williams drug classification according to the mechanism of action. There are five types of drug classes. We will see what are they. Here is the Wagens-Williams classification. Class 1 agents. These agents will interfere with the sodium channel and called as membrane stabilizing agents, because it will decrease the excitogenicity of plasma membrane. Class 1 agents are divided into three groups, class 1A, 1B and 1C, based upon their effect on the length of action potential. These are the three groups in class 1 drugs. Let's see how they are affecting on the action potential. Class 1A is moderate reduction in phase 0 slope and increased action potential duration and increased effective refractive period. Let's see the graph here. It is moderately affecting the phase 0 slope, and it is affecting the action potential duration and increasing the effective refractive period. Here, from here to here, it is effective refractive period, and it is increasing the effective refractive period. And class 1B, it is small reduction in phase 0 slope, reduce action potential duration, decrease effective refractive period. Let's see here, it is a small reduction in the phase 0 slope, and it is reduced action potential duration. The gap between this 0 to 3, it is reduced, and effective refractive period also reduced. And class 1C, pronounced reduction in phase 0 slope, no effect on the action potential duration or effective refractive period. Here, pronounced reduction of phase 0 slope and no effect on the action potential duration and effective refractive period. And class 2 agents, these are conventional beta blockers. It will block the effect of catecholamines at the beta 1 adrenergic receptors, thereby decreasing sympathetic activity on the heart. They decrease conduction through AV node, so they are good for SVT. Examples: atenolol, esmolol, propranolol and metoprolol. Class 3 agents. These are blocking the potassium channel, thereby prolonging the repolarization. Since these agents do not affect the sodium channel, conduction velocity is not decreased. The prolongation of action potential duration and refractory period combined with normal conduction velocity prevent re-entrant arrhythmias. Examples: amiodarone, ebutolide, sotalol and ritalium. Class 4 agents. These are calcium channel blockers. They decrease conduction through AV node and shorten phase 2. Thus, they reduce contractility of the heart. Examples: verapamil and diltiazem. Class 5 agents. These are miscellaneous drugs that do not fit cleanly into 1 to 4 categories. Example: digoxin, which decreases conduction through AV node and increases vagal activity via central nervous system, leads to increased acetylcholine production, which is stimulating M2 receptors on AV node, leading to overall decrease in speed of conduction. Adenosine, it slows conduction time through AV node. can interrupt with the re-entry pathways through AV node and can restore normal sinus rhythm in patients with supraventricular tachycardia. Magnesium sulfate, very specific antiarrhythmic drug. It terminates dorsal. See the graph here. It is explaining drugs affecting the cardiac action potential. Class 1, sodium channel blocker. Class 1A, 1B, and 1C drugs reduce the movement of sodium ions into the cell during phase 0. Class 1A, it is a moderate sodium channel blocker, such as quinidine and procainamide. 1B, it is a weak sodium channel blocker, such as lidocaine and phenytoin. And 1C, it's a strong sodium channel blocker, examples flecainide and propafenone. And class 4 drugs, it inhibits calcium slow influx during phase 2, and it is lengthened the phase. They also depress phase 4 and lengthen phase 1 and 2, such as verapamil and diltiazem. Class 3 drugs prolong phase 3, which increase repolarization and refractory periods, such as amiodarone and cetalol. And class 2 drugs, it is inhibiting the adrenergic stimulation of cardiac tissue by depressing phase 4, spontaneous depolarization, and slowing sinoatrial node impulses. In summary, note down these points. Sodium channel is triggering the cardiac contractility. By blocking this channel, you can delay the triggering phase of the cardiac action potential. And the calcium channel is responsible for continuity of the contraction. By blocking this channel, you can shorten the contraction time or the plative phase of the cardiac action potential. And the potassium channel is responsible for relaxation of the cardiac muscle. By blocking this, repolarization delay will occur. And beta adrenal receptors is working with the sympathetic action of the heart. It will increase the conduction, contractility, and the rate. By blocking this, the sympathetic activity of the heart will be suppressed. Just keep these points in your mind so that you can easily determine the desired outcome or how the heart will respond whenever you are using these antiarrhythmic agents, and take necessary precautions. One important point is to remember, all the antiarrhythmic agents are proarrhythmic. It can cause arrhythmia by itself. So be alert always while you are using these drugs. I hope you enjoy my class, so please share with your friends and subscribe my YouTube channel with name Sanjay Pare. Thank you. Bye-bye.